Today I am going to demonstrate you hysteroscopic instrument design in hysteroscopy. That what is diagnostic sheath, what is operative sheath, what is resectoroscope, what are different type of resectoroscope, how to assemble it, how to disassemble it, what are the advantages, what are different type of electrode and clinical uses. So first instrument which you should learn is hysteroscope. Hysteroscope, a standard hysteroscope is 4mm 30 degree telescope. And there are micro and mini hysteroscope also. Mini hysteroscope is 1.8 mm. With the sheath it becomes 2.2 mm. That is also called as versascope. And there are micro hysteroscope also which has 80 to 150 micron magnification, so that you can see the nuclei or cytoplasm also. But that hysteroscope is beyond the scope because it is used by embryologists, cytologists. It is not we are using for surgery. So for surgery, a standard is 4mm 30 degree telescope. Now alone hysteroscope cannot be inserted into the cervix. It won't show you anything. So you need a sheath, and the first sheath which you have to insert is diagnostic sheath. Diagnostic single channel sheath, it has only one channel and it has an obturator. This is obturator and this is single channel sheath. Single channel sheath is used for just a diagnostic advantage. How to introduce, how to assemble any sheath. Any sheath on the hysteroscopy, how to assemble, I would like to show you that if you see here on the hysteroscope, here it is written zero. At this point there is a groove and on the sheath there are two lines. Can you see these two lines? Yes, you can see that. Did you see two lines? I will show you these lines. This is away from each other. And this is parallel to each other, isn't it? If it is away from each other, it is of no use. You cannot put that hysteroscope. If it is parallel to each other, then only it will take anything. If it is away from each other, it is not aligned, it is locked. So you have to bring it parallel to each other, and then this zero line of the telescope should go here like this. And then turn it to the clockwise direction and it is locked. Now see, it is not dropping. It is locked. Again, if you have to open it, you need to bring this parallel to that. And then it comes out. This is a standard rule for all the hysteroscopic instruments. If it is resectoscope, it is operating sheath, if it is diagnostic sheath, it is a standard rule. That these two parallel lines should be each other and then only you can open it. And always to lock clockwise, unlock anti-clockwise. This is everywhere. Even in the bottle also, the cap of the bottle clockwise is locking, anti-clockwise is opening. So here if you will anti-clockwise open, attach it and clockwise it is locked. So this is diagnostic sheath. Diagnostic sheath, if you are using 30 degree telescope, then during introduction, light cable should be down in antiverted uterus. So you should do PV examination, bimanual examination or laparoscope to make it sure it is antiverted or retroverted. So light cable, if it is down, it will show you better to enter into the antiverted uterus. If accidentally you during entry, and once you enter, then you have to turn to the right side to see left ostia. Your left is patient right and left side you see right ostia. So this is diagnostic sheath. Diagnostic sheath need only up to 5 number of Hager dilator dilatation. If the patient is nulliparous, you should keep mesoprost 400 microgram 2 to 4 hours before the procedure so that cervix will little bit soft and then it can be introduced. In multipara don't do that. and don't use Hager, a lot of fluid will start leaking out, you will be in trouble. Now question is, if I am using the 5 mm sheath, normal cervical canal diameter opening is 3 to 10 mm, 3 mm in the nulliparous, sometime less, and it may be 10 mm in the grand multipara, isn't it? So if it is a 10 mm cervical canal and if this goes, all the fluid will leak out. So what is the option? Option is use a Melger knot, endo loop, and first you put it and then tie a knot, extracorporeal knot around the cervix. And that will stop the leaking of the fluid. Or you should use 4-channel sheath, which I am showing you later, 4-channel sheath. So this is regarding the diagnostic sheath. Diagnostic sheath will not do anything except showing you the uterine cavity. It doesn't have any channel for the fluid to, except fluid to go. Here is the fluid input. Even the fluid exit is not there. Sometimes once you enter and you see everything dirty, and if it is no leak, then you have to detach it and open this again to drain the water, and again new fluid should go. Am I clear? Because exit channels are not there. So it will only show you the vision. You can identify the myoma, adhesion, Asherman, lost IUCD or whatever. After that, you remove it, and if you want to do any operative procedure, you need 4-channel sheath. This is the 4-channel sheath. This is the obturator of the 4-channel sheath. And it has 4 channels. What are the channels? This channel is for telescope, this channel is for instrument, and 2 channels for fluid. Now I have a question, which channel for fluid input and which channel for fluid output? Pardon? Up is for? No, light is always in telescope, light is not in channel. Here there is no telescope, it is only channel. Only sheath. So up is for entry and down is for exit. Okay, now I am making this down and this up. Now what you will do? Pardon? Yes, near one. Nearer one is for both can be up also and both can be, you can make both down also. So it is wrong. Always you should try to nearer one is for input and away from exit, because outer sheath, this is outer sheath, I will show you, outer sheath is after inner sheath and this is for exit. Do you know if you will put accidentally this one in for entry, what will happen? Is any problem? Do you know if you see here it has a multiple perforation, can you see that? It has multiple perforation here. And accidentally, if you have attached the input here, it is covered by the cervix. And then fluid will not go. Fluid always has to enter from the inner sheath. See here, at the tip, if you will see, there are 3 openings. The bigger opening is for telescope. The medium size is for instrument. And the small size is for fluid. So fluid always should go from the tip of the instrument. If fluid, you will go from periphery, it will not. Do you know cervix is the last thing which open? Fluid first go uterine cavity, it will inflate the uterine, after that internal loss, and then cervical canal open. So if outer sheath accidentally you attach for the fluid, This opening is on the surroundings and it will be a big problem. So don't do that. And it will leak also. It will leak out. It will not go to the cavity. So inner sheath, this is inner sheath and this is outer sheath. Now, telescope again, how to attach? This is our telescope. And here you can see that this is our lining. This is the lining. So I keep the lining like that, these 2 lining together, and then telescope I will drop it like this. Telescope has 0 line here, this both is, and then rotate it clockwise, it is locked. It is locked now. If you have to open, just you go anti-clock and then it is out. Again attach it and clockwise it is locked. Now, what I can do, I can attach one fluid entry and fluid exit. Remember, it when you buy, some company they cheat. What they cheat? They will give you this type of four channel, like this. They will say you, this is four channel. It is not four channel. These two channels are same. This is bad. Once you put fluid input, and then you do fluid output, from the tube itself, fluid input, fluid output is going. So it is useless. It is actually double channel. It is not four channel. In real four channel, fluid input is by the tip. And once the fluid go to the cavity, then it return out. So it is, it should be a real four channel. How? You should inspect that there should be one third opening at the tip. So see, this bigger one was for telescope. Here, can you see that? This is, and telescope is in. And now lock it. After that, medium size is for instrumentation. And you can use various instruments. And these all instruments are flexible instruments. These are beautiful instruments, like here. And these instruments are flexible instruments. So you can just bend it, and it is completely flexible. You will see here that it is like that. See? It is entirely flexible. Keep it close, and then introduce it in the working channel. Here you go. And what is this? Here you have, this is seizures. If you will see, it is a beautiful seizures, and it can be used for Asserman syndrome, or you can have the flimsy adhesions. So this is seizures. Here you see. Can you see the tip of seizures? And you can use to cut. And here it is flexible. Even if it is going this side or that side, no issue. It is flexible and you can use it to cut. And this can be used, even you can cut your mustache also with this. So this is very fine seizures. It is a fine seizure which is very flexible. And what you will use for? You will use for Asserman. Mostly the Asserman you will use. How to use it? I will just demonstrate you. That suppose you have Asserman like that. And here is the cold seizures which is cutting. While you are performing operative procedure, if suddenly your vision is lost, then bring everything out and pack up. Means you have perforated. So don't continue. Otherwise, right now you have only perforated the uterus. After that you are going to perforate the bowel also. So immediately everything was going, especially in Asserman it is quite not, means often. That you are going and suddenly you don't have a depth perception and suddenly it opens. So this is cold seizures, and slowly these all the adhesions can be cut. So this is other instrument which is possible, is you have the graspers, biopsy forceps, claw forceps. This is grasper and it can hold the big jaw and it can catch the lost IUCD or any other structure. It is a beautiful instrument which is used, and it all goes through that. Then you have the, now, this four channel seed, what it cannot do? It cannot use current. There is no provision to use current. You cannot coagulate, you cannot attach any electrocautery. And what it can do? It can do grasper, it can do seizures, it can do the different type of biopsy forceps. It can use even for putting the uretary catheter for chromotubation. This is the uretary catheter. You will open it and then you can use it for chromatubation. And it has, do you know, there are three type of tubal patency tests commonly used. One is HSG, isn't it? If HSG is showing tube is open, it has 100% value. If HSG is showing that tube is blocked, it doesn't have any value. After that, you have to do tubal patency test. Tubal patency test by laparoscopy. If tubal patency test is showing that tube is open, it has 100% value. If it is showing that tube is closed, it has only 80% value. 20% no value. After that, you have to do the third test, that is chromatubation. And chromatubation, if it is saying that it is closed, then it has only value. So this is the sixth French ureteric catheter which you have to introduce. And soft part is here, which is completely closed. And through that working channel you will go. You have to use guide wire as well. Here is a guide wire also. This guide wire has two parts. I will show you. The guide wire has two parts. It is very important that this part is dangerous. See, if I will do like that, it is pricking my, can you see the skin? It is pricking. And this part is beautiful. Even if you put my eye, it will not perforate. See? It doesn't have any indent. Can you see any dimpling? No. It is very soft. Absolutely soft. I am putting the finger, nothing happens. It is so soft. It can never prick anything. Even the skin, even the cheek, it cannot prick. Even the finger, it cannot prick. So this soft part should be towards the tip, and then you will introduce it. This is the guide wire I am introducing to the ureteric catheter, six French ureteric catheter. Here you go. And then only 2 centimeters of the tip should be out. This is soft part here. And after that, introduce it into this working channel. And here you go. And then it will enter inside. And then you rotate it. Once you rotate, automatically it will get the tip will deflate it. It is deflecting like. And then you go to the catheter in the cavity and do the chromatubation. Not only do, you can do laparoscopy also. How it is done? Like suppose you want to see it and you can have the laparoscopy to perform. Laparoscopy has an advantage. Here there are guide wire going, and this is laparoscopic view. This is uterus. This is a guide wire. And it's so soft that it will not perforate. It keep on bending and then it is coming out. And once it is out, you can introduce the laparoscope. Laparoscope has advantage that it can find out all the ciliary movement and the status of the tubal mucosa. Here this is light of the laparoscope. Can you see that? This is the light of the laparoscope here. Do you know, in the woman who is a lot of smoking, their tube may be patent, but there is no cilia. There is no cilia. And then they become infertile. Because in spite of having the patent tube, that tube doesn't have any, yes, ciliary movement. So this way you can use. And this is how the four channel sheath can give you these options. And again you can attach, you can take the guide wire out. Now I am taking this guide wire out. This is the guide wire out. And after that you have a tubing and you can attach this tubing here. They will give you one attachment in the tube itself. And you can inject the dye. Once the dye will be injected, you can do chromatubation. So this is regarding the four-channel sheath. So four-channel sheath is very useful. Sometime what happened, you have lost IUCD. And you have to retrieve that Here is the IUCD. Patient, this is a grass pad holding the IUCD, and everything will be pulled together. How we hold the gallbladder with the claw, forceps or appendix and bring everything together. And you hold it and it is coming out. So this is a beautiful instrument which has a versatile use. Asserman cold seizures you can do, and laparoscopy you can do, and all the other procedures which doesn't need energy, you can use it. For that you need true four-channel sheath. Now, next, so this is, yes? And hysteroscopy, yes, laparoscopy, both together. Then only you can safely enter, otherwise you are perforating, you don't know. And you have to see the dye coming through the fimbria. So laparoscopy is must. When you are doing laparoscopy and hysteroscopy together, what is called? Pelvicoscopy. It is called as pelvicoscopy. It is a combination of laparoscopy or hysteroscopy together. Access will be laparoscope first, and after that you will, as he was, one of your friend was pointing, that sometime in nulliparous or all the Syrian section, after pneumoperitoneum, cervix sometime get pulled up. So if you are facing this difficulty, then access is first, after that for a time being deflated, and then catch the, with the tenaculum, the cervix, and once you have done the sound, then again, once the hysteroscope is inflate the, again do the pneumoperitoneum. And under vision, because all the cannulation, instrumentation, assessment, do you know, if you are doing diagnostic hysteroscopy, then laparoscopy is not required. But if you are doing the operative hysteroscopy like metroplasty or large assessment, always under laparoscopic guidance. So after that, suppose you have to use the energy, then you will use resectoscope. Resectoscope is the same instrument which is used by the urologist for the prostate surgery, other surgery. Resectoscope has five parts actually. First is called as working element. This is working element. It is like a pistol. This is working element. Second part of resectoscope is, this is inner sheath. How you will know inner sheath? It has a ceramic tip. It has two purposes. One purpose is to keep the insulation around the electrode, and it can withstand very high temperature up to 350 degrees centigrade also. It doesn't melt. And it is a insulation. So this is inner sheath, which doesn't allow the current to go to the metal part. And fluid input also through the inner sheath. And after inner sheath, you have outer sheath. This is outer sheath. Outer sheath has two functions. One function, it acts as a port. Another function is fluid exit. What I mean act as a port? Why you use port in laparoscopy? Port means pathway of entry and exit. We can directly puncture one Maryland and do the laparoscopy. Yes, you can do, but only one time. You have to take the Maryland out, again seizure out, again grasper. How many times you will puncture? So you are making a port. So that it will easily facilitate your input and exit. So this you should use as a port. Whenever you have to change the electrode, or whenever you have to clean it, don't remove outer sheath. Leave outer sheath in the cervix and bring inner sheath, working element, telescope and electrode together. How to do? I will show you later. So this is outer sheath. Now the third part is electrodes. So these are the three. Working element, inner sheath, outer sheath. And after that you have a series of the electrodes. These electrodes are important. And these electrodes are, a lot of electrodes are there, depending upon the size. This is loop electrode, this is Collins knife, this is a straight knife. And you can use these different electrodes for different purposes. Roller ball, Collins knife is like a L-hook, a straight knife is a straight, and roller ball, these are electrodes. Any electrode can fit. And the last is telescope. So we have a telescope here attached in the outer and in the, and it is telescope. So these are the five components together. This is called as resectoscope. Right now it is not called as resectoscope. All are separate. Now you have to assemble it. How to assemble? I will show you. First you take working element. This is working element. And after that, in the working element, you attach the electrode. Take the electrode and drop it into the working element like that. And here it is going in. Now there is a button here. Never push the electrode hard, it will break and it will be a big drawback. And your instrument also gets spoiled. Here is a button. This one. Here. So press it and then you push it in. And then release it. It is locked. So without pressing this button, working element should not be pushed. Again, if you have to remove it, press this button and then pull it out. See? It is out. And you have to push it, keep it pressed and go, and then it is locked. So this is because there is a ball. If you will see here, on the back of the working element, here is a ball. Can you see that? And this ball get locked by the lever. So you have to drop it like this inside and then you go here and keep it pressed and then here click. It will give you sound. And as soon as you go, click and then attached. And now after that, once the working element is attached with the electrode, this is which electrode? Let us see, this is a loop electrode. This is a loop. Loop is used for myomectomy, TCRE, transcervical resection of endometrium. After that, you will put the inner sheath. This is inner sheath. Again, it will drop and you will attach. And here is clockwise. As soon as you turn clockwise, it is locked. It is not going to drop now. After that, you will take the outer sheath. Again, this outer sheath is attached. And there are lever here, point, and go and rotate it into the clockwise direction. This should be on the same line. This zero and this should be on the same line. And then you have to rotate clockwise. Just 1 minute. It has to be fixed. Just. Sometime it may not be off. We have 2-3 outer. Yes. Now it is locked. And once it is locked, it will not open again. It is done. And it is locked. After that, what you do? When I am pressing it, this is disappearing. Can you see that? Here. And when I am leaving it, it is out. There are two types of resectoscope. One is active, other is passive. Here, by default, electrode is out. So during entry, I have to keep it pressed. Isn't it? If I will leave it, it will be by default out. So this is active resectoscope. Accidentally, if you will press, suppose it is in, and accidentally your nurse will press the paddle, it will perforate. So by default, always when you are not working, keep it pressed. Am I correct? So that it is in. If you will not leave it, if you will not do that, and if you are unattended like this, and you are talking to someone or taking some instrument and it is in the cavity, it will perforate. But good thing about ergonomically, it is more understable. That when you are pulling it, it is coming towards you. So in the myomectomy, you can go away and scoop it down. So it moves little bit, ergonomically you feel it more what we do in day-to-day life. In day-to-day life, if you have to scoop the ice cream from the container, what do? You go with the scoop and pull towards you. It is not like you are pulling towards you and it is going away from you. So here it is more ergonomically convenient to learn. that you are pulling it and it is cutting from away towards you, cutting away towards you. And then you will last, you will attach the telescope. And here is the telescope. To attach the telescope again, it will go like that. And these two lines will be parallel to each other and lock it. And now telescope is also attached. Telescope will not come up. So this is, now this once the all the five components are assembled together, then it is called as resectoscope. Now question is, what are the surgeries resectoscope you can do? Submucous myoma, can do. Polypectomy, can do. Metroplasty, can do. And TCRE, transcervical resection of endometrium, can do. Chromatumation, cannot do. Esserman, cutting the adhesion, cannot do. Removal of the this IUCD, cannot do. Taking biopsy, cannot do. So it should only be used if you need current. And it doesn't have any other channel to introduce your ureteric catheter or the any forceps or suture. No, it is already pre-occupied, all the channel is filled. Now time to time you have to remove it to change the resectoscope electrode. How to change it? Just you rotate this one and bring all these three out. What are the things you are bringing out? Telescope, working element and inner sheath. And this don't remove. This don't remove. After that, you take a leak evacuator. This is a leak evacuator. Attach the leak evacuator into this and then pump it. This way you will pump it. And it will be filled with the fluid. And once you pump it, it will create a turbulence of the fluid inside and it will suck all the cut chips of the polyp or myoma. Because with the electrode, you cannot cut at one time more than 2 millimeter chips. So it won't obstruct. And due to the turbulence, all is there. And now this has a filter which will give you for biopsy also. So this is a leak evacuator. Once you have cleaned it, then again clean the tip of the resectoscope, again introduce it in, all together go and lock. And then again started doing further resection, and you will do this. So this is the active variety. Another type of resectoscope is passive. Here this is passive. Now I am changing here again to change the electrode, and you will attach it to the electrode. So unfortunately in this one they have broken the knob here. So I have to use something to move it. Yes. Now it is out and I am attaching the Collins knife. Here it is the Collins knife. And Collins knife is used for metroplasty. Again I am pressing the red button here and locked. And it is locked. Now I will make it sure that it is by default it is good. And then these two sheath will be again attached and here it will be locked. It is locked. Now, just 1 minute. In this one, by default, it will be in. Yes. So both the resectoscope is attached. Yes. If you see here, by default, it is in. Here, it is in. When I am pressing it, it is out. Isn't it? And when I am leaving it, it again goes in. So by default you don't have a worry about accidentally injuring somewhere. And in this one you have to move the thumb. If you press the thumb, it go in. If you pull the thumb, it come out. And in this one you have to press the finger. Can you see that? Here finger is moving. Thumb is static. Am I correct? And in this one, thumb is moving. Can you see that? And finger is static. But the problem here is little bit inconvenient to perform. When you press it, jaw is out. When you leave it, jaw is in. So this is passive. Because by default, electrode is not outside. And you can leave it inside without the injury. And when you press it, it comes out. So this is regarding. Now, another instrument what you have is called Medex pump. This is a Medex pump. Medex is one of the American company which has first made this pump. And it has a lock here. You know, in hysteroscopy, you need 150 to 180 millimeter mercury pressure. And at that pressure, because it is a tight, collapsed air dome-like cavity, and that pressure, some people, what they do, they use Y-channel. This is a Y-channel. Why Y-channel? It has two channels. And they pierce it into the saline bottle, and they put one pump in the saline bottle, and they put air in the bottle itself. It is good, but it is unmonitored. There is no monitoring how much pressure you are applying. Another problem is, suppose you are not seeing an entire fluid in, and then air enters, it can create air embolism. So ideally, pumping the air in the bottle is not a good technique. You can use two, three things there. One thing is you can use the, Medex pump. Another, you can use the different type of hysteroflator. Hysteroflator is just like an insufflator. A starch is making it by the name of endomet. If you will go to the Google, then many companies are making it with the different brand name, and all are called as hysteroflator. These are the different hysteroflator, and this is the different company names. Can you see that? This is Olympus hysteroflator, Star hysteroflator. All is good. And it is a fluid insufflator. This is hysteroflator. From Olympus, from Star, all the companies are making. But it is expensive. The cost would be approximately 3 to 4 lakh rupees. And it will monitor your input of the fluid and output of the fluid also. How much you have in, how much you have out. So generally, you don't need to that much cost. You can use Medex pump. You can open it, and you can hang it. It has a hook to hang 1 liter to 3 liter. Two sizes are available: 1 liter to 3 liter bottle, and then you can wrap it around. And it is just like a BP cuff. Some people they use BP cuff also, but BP cuff has a problem. It is not made up of silicone. It is rubber. It is not that much long, so it make a dumbbell. In the middle of the bottle, it will be constricted up and down, it is inflated like a dumbbell. So you should use this Medex pump, and it has one other beauty, that BP cuff pressure only go up to 180, 200, that's all. Here the good thing about, after 300, you can see there is a red color line. Can you see that? Here. Did you see? And this is red. As soon as your pressure go to the red line, there is a safety valve. It open. If you have more than 300 millimeter mercury pressure inside the uterus, your patient will get what? Your patient may die on the table due to vasovagal shock. So don't think that over pressure is going to be very good thing for you. So that's why Medex pump has a safety limit. That as soon as it go to the area where vasovagal shock can happen, it will immediately decrease and it will a safety valve open and it will bring the pressure down. So this is a cheaper alternative. Cost is 6,000-7,000 rupees for original Medex. If you want to buy Indian, it will costing you 800-900 rupees also. It is available in the market. So this is also required for hysteroscope. So these are the only instrument which is commonly used, and in the hysteroscopy you have to use. So, any question? Yes. Yes, that is the problem, that in hysteroscopy maximum movement will be to and fro. If you are moving contralateral, then entire uterus started moving. So in those situations, that's why some of the flexible instrument and little rotation 30 degree telescope will give you little maneuverability, but it is not like laparoscopy that you have the angle, manipulation angle, azimuth angle. These things, azimuth angle here is zero. Why telescope and instruments are parallel? So azimuth angle is zero. Any other question? Yes? Colposcopy, you want? Colposcopy is basically to detect the that you can do even by laparoscope also. Simple laparoscope also can be give you the vaginoscope. So yes. So then another part of the question. Of course, if you are doing in multipara, you should not dilate. Even in nulliparous, if you have a good prostaglandin given, let the fluid dilate. Because if you are doing Heger's dilator or traumatizing the cervix, then you have more problem. But do you know for that you need a small size hysteroscope? So she might be using the versioscope. In versioscope, or even in the, this versioscope is a fiber optic hysteroscope. This is rod lens. So even in the rod lens, 2.2 mm coming. So if you use that, you don't need dilate at all. That's why it is called as office hysteroscopy. And office hysteroscopy has only one limitation. That entering inside is okay, but suppose you have a big myoma and you are cutting the chips, then retrieval is difficult, isn't it? So for operative, you have to do a standard hysteroscope. But of course, if you want to do it, it is good to have the fine microhysteroscopes. So, any other question? Any other question regarding any other laparoscopy also? Pardon? Okay, very good question. Although it will be, tomorrow you have practical also, but I will tell you. When hysteroscopy was started, then carbon dioxide was the only media which was start with. But CO2 has a lot of problem. That you can do for 4-5 minutes. If you will extend it, a lot of pneumoperitoneum will form. Because it is leaking from the fimbria, it is distending the abdomen. Isn't it? Another problem is you cannot do operative. You will do operative, it will smoke your telescope. Because inside the air environment, blood also coagulate and it will soil your telescope. So fluid is preferred. And in fluid, for most of the people, for diagnostic hysteroscopy, normal saline is the preferred fluid. But under normal saline environment, you cannot do operative. If you want to do operative under normal saline, you have to buy Versa point. That is bipolar generator for hysteroscopic resection. So, most of the time when you use for monopolar operative resectoscope, you have to use glycine. Because glycine has many advantages. One advantage, it is not ionizable solution. It isn't ionized like sodium chloride. Another advantage is it prevents clot formation. It acts as an anticoagulant. So, one beautiful property is that if clot doesn't form, it will keep on leaking out from your exit channel. If clot forms, it will occlude your channel. So, other advantage is it is a natural amino acid in the body, but one very bad disadvantage is hyponatremia. Hyponatremia. So, you have to use very carefully. Some people, they use sterile water, that is distilled water. But the problem is it has its own complication of water intoxication. So if you want to prevent these problems, then you can use the advanced resectoscope that is called as Versa point. And Versa point is a bipolar resectoscope for hysteroscopy. And this versa point is gynecare. Gynecare is, as you know, is a branch of ethicon gyne division. And it's a beautiful generator. And it's a bipolar. This is bipolar. And this versa point, you don't need glycine. You can work with the simple normal saline. And it is a plasma kinetic energy. As we know, at that frequency, even the bipolar cuts. But again, problem is, you should have a very rich pocket, because it will cost you 15 lakh rupees. And you have to buy from them, and you need to do that. And all the instrument also you have to buy from them. You cannot buy from outside. So, any other question? So, thank you very much.